Hey, Sanger Bible, it is so good to see you guys. My name is Pete. I have the privilege of being a senior pastor here, and I just wanted to welcome you guys. Welcome to our time here today. Just want to give you guys a couple of things and caught up on what's going on, and just let you know there's a few things that are happening in the next couple of weeks that we wanted to kind of start rolling out. But we can't give you too many details because we're still trying to find and get everything ready behind the scenes before we roll it out. May 16th, some of you guys are today. Some of you guys are seeing that today. We are reopening our gatherings indoors, and so we're going to be having gatherings at 9 a.m. and 10:45. There is no need to register for kids code. No need to register. You just show up. We will still be doing social distancing seating, and so we want to encourage you guys. If you guys are able, willing, and comfortable, we are back indoors gathering. And so now, if you're going to be still watching online, that's great. Just so to kind of give you an update on what's going to be happening next week, hopefully on the 20th, we're going to be launching a new website. And on our new website, you're going to find our online sermons, our weekly sermons, under the tab of resources. And so we won't be sending out the text weekly anymore. The text app, we're going to be doing away with that. We're going to have a different way of communication. But with the launch of the new website, you can find everything on the new website. Still Sanger Bible. And so as we make that change, I just wanted to kind of let you know where you're going to be able to go to the new website, and under the resources tab, you'll find our sermons, and on there you'll click on it, and then you'll be able to find the newest the sermon. And in that, in the details, you'll find there'll be three questions. It's going to be the three same questions every week that you can help process the sermon with, and then all the events, everything is going to be on our new website. And so be on the lookout for that, just be part of what we're doing. Now, Sanger Bible, we're always saying that we're family, and so we want to know who is watching, who's getting connected, and so please reach out. My email is pete@sangerbible.com. Send me an email. I'd love to either chat with you, either use Zoom, a phone call, text, or even grab coffee. We want to make sure if you're calling Sanger Bible your home church, we would truly want you to be connected and figure out a way we can really be the church together. And so enjoy our time today. We're going to be in Matthew chapter 8 this week. And so we're excited for Jacob to bring the message. Wherever you may be, wherever you are watching this, we pray that the Father would use the Holy Spirit to guide your spirit today, to guide your mind and your heart to know Him, to apply His words today to everything that you do. Jesus, we give you all the glory. And so I lift up to you the message today. And wherever people are watching, I pray that they hear your words clearly, and they feel the Holy Spirit and know that the Holy Spirit is working in them to apply the text today so that we would be more like you, Jesus, in everything that we do. We pray this, Jesus, in your name. Amen.
Sometimes people say strange things that make a lot of sense. This past week, one of those things that I heard was someone asked the question, do you find that you talk to yourself or that you listen to yourself? Do you find that you talk to yourself or do you listen to yourself? Let me explain. I, for one, often have a critic in my head that often talks to me, about the things that I do, about my performance, about how well I've done or how far I've fallen short. And it's these voices in my head, don't get too creeped out, right? these things in my head, that these things I keep telling myself. Or I know some others who have this narrative that keeps playing in their mind of, I don't have what it takes. They listen to themselves. They say, I don't have what it takes. I've been abandoned. I'm not worthy. I can't do this. I can't make it through today. I can't do this. So he asked the question, and the guy that I heard ask this question was preaching on Psalm 42, and so it helped make this psalm make a lot more sense for me. Do you find that you talk to yourself or listen to yourself? And the psalmist gives us an interesting model for actually talking to ourselves instead of listening to ourselves. And some of you are familiar with the psalm. The psalmist asks this question. He says, why are you cast down, O my soul? Why are you in turmoil within me? Hope in God, for I shall again praise him, my salvation and my God. And for me, it clicked. It sounded strange at first. Do I talk to myself or listen to myself? But then to see what the psalmist does here is he actually talks to himself. He says, why are you cast down, O my soul? Why are you in turmoil within me? Well, guys, I have the privilege this morning of preaching to you the sermon that I've been preaching to myself all week. In fact, this was one week where Pete offered to take the sermon off my plate because my life was in a bit of turmoil. It still is. And Pete offered to take it, and part of the reason why I wanted to keep it, even though, you know, it makes life crazier trying to prepare for this, is because this is the sermon that I needed to hear. This is the sermon that I've been preaching to myself this whole week. I've been preaching it to someone else this whole week. This is what I needed to hear, and so I'm praying in God's mercy and generosity that it may be one for you as well. Because I could relate somewhat to the psalmist in Psalm 42. That's where I went there. That's why I went there to begin with. He says things like this. He says, tears have been my food day and night. He says, while others, they say to me all day long, where is your God? By the way, when people ask, hey, where is your God? It's because it looks like you've been abandoned, like your God has left you. And he says, I say to God, my rock, why have you forgotten me? I mean, why do I go mourning because of the oppression of my enemy? As with deadly wounds in my bones, my adversaries, they taunt me. While they say to me all day long, where is your God? He's saying this narrative over and over, but then he begins to talk to himself in that verse we mentioned. Why are you cast down? Why are you in turmoil? Hope in God, for I will yet praise him. So this week, today, church, I want to give you guys three questions. Three questions that I want you to answer when you're in this kind of situation. Three questions that you can answer to talk to yourselves when you can relate to this kind of psalmist and you can relate to someone else we're about to see here in a minute. So the first question is going to come from me. The second question is going to come from Jesus. And the third question is going to come from the disciples. All right? Only because that's how the text is ordered. There's no priority. My question is not more important than Jesus. We've got three of them. From me, Jesus, and the disciples. All three of these will go together. So if you guys have your Bibles, we're going to look at these three questions to answer in talking to yourselves. Open up to Matthew chapter 8. Matthew chapter 8, verse 23. And it's a familiar story, but I want to read it to you. Matthew chapter 8, verse 23. And when he, Jesus, got into the boat, his disciples followed him. And look, there arose a great storm on the sea, so that the boat was being swamped by the waves, but he was asleep. And so they went and they woke him, saying, save us, Lord, we're perishing. And he said to them, why are you afraid, O you of little faith?
And then he rose and rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a great calm. The men marveled, saying, "What sort of man is this, that even the winds and the sea obey him?"
Now, maybe of you are likely, many of you are familiar with this story. For me, trying to read through it, it's this challenge of when things are familiar, it's easy to glaze over them and to ask the tough questions of what is this actually about? And so if you're familiar with this story, we want to ask, what is this actually about? And we find out that this story is actually coming out of a story just prior. And if you look just prior to this story of Jesus going out onto the water, back in Matthew 8, verse 18, it says that, "Now when Jesus saw the crowd around him, he gave orders to go over to the other side." Now, I love this about Jesus because I often feel this way, right? It's like the crowd is getting bigger and you're like, "I want to get out of here," right? like I'm an introvert at heart. So I would rather not be in a crowd. I'd rather get in the boat and go over to the other side. And this is Jesus doing just that same thing. The crowd is growing bigger and bigger and Jesus says, "Hey, let's get out of here," right? And as he's trying to get out, it's the sermon that Pete preached last week of a couple guys coming saying, "Hey, Jesus, I'm going to come with you, but first let me go do this thing," right? "I want to follow you, but I've got some other priorities I got to take care of first." And then Jesus, he says in verse 22, he says to them, "Follow me." And then he gets in the boat and he's going to go across. And this story is coming out of that. It's out of Jesus moving away from the crowds and yet calling his disciples to follow him. So the question is, are they going to follow? And that's where we get to the beginning of our text. It's a response to Jesus wanting to go to the other side and calling his disciples to follow him as the crowd is getting bigger. And so Jesus, what we notice is that, and when he got into the boat, his disciples did what? They followed him. And a couple of interesting things. I mean, this is so simple. It's a text we're familiar with. But the first one is that Jesus is the first one in the boat. Jesus gets in the boat first. Now, Jesus, he knows where he's going. He's going to the other side. He knows what will happen between where he is and where he's going. And he's there in the boat the entire trip. Jesus is in the boat. He's the first one in the boat. The second is that the disciples then come and they follow him. The disciples follow. They obey his command. Now, we don't know how many disciples. We don't know how much elbow room they had on the boat. I mean, I don't know if they're packing in like sardines. They found boats that are probably something like this that could fit a dozen or so people. But we know that his disciples follow him. But who are the disciples? Interestingly enough, if you're reading through the Gospel of Matthew as we go through this, Jesus has only called two disciples so far of the 12. Only two of the 12, which means we can't actually assume that the other 10 are the rest of the disciples. Those disciples aren't called until Matthew 9 and 10. And I think this is pretty strategic of Matthew in a way. The two disciples that have been identified are Peter and Andrew, who by trade are what? Fishermen, right? So there's two at least experienced fishermen on the boat that go with Jesus. We could pretty well assume that they're some of these disciples from Matthew's account, but the others, we don't know who. We just know there's a line being drawn in the sand between the disciples who follow Jesus into the boat and the crowds that are gathering otherwise. But it's this unique way of Matthew giving us this invitation, an invitation of discipleship, for the disciples to come into the boat with Jesus. The disciples distinguish themselves from the rest of the crowd because they're the ones who obey Jesus's command to follow him and get into the boat. Church, this is a story about discipleship. This is a story about people who want to follow Jesus. And so then in verse 24, look, "There arose a great storm on the sea, so that the boat was being swamped by the waves." Now, this great storm is literally a great shaking. And one of the things you can do as you study the Bible is when there's words like this, you can look at, you know, kind of unique words. Where else does Matthew use this kind of a word? And this is one of them. There's literally this great shaking. It appears three other times in the Gospel of Matthew. And this helps us kind of put the severity of this shaking into perspective. Three other times in the Gospel of Matthew. One is with the signs at the end times. There's a great shaking with the signs at the end times. Another time there's this great shaking is right at the crucifixion. Jesus breathes his last, the curtain is torn in two, and there's this tumultuous shaking. Same word.
Now, the third one is when the angel comes down from heaven, rolls back the rock, and then sits on it, and Jesus resurrects. There's a great shaking. So put the scale of this shaking into perspective with the end times, the crucifixion, and the resurrection. Guys, this isn't just a light earthquake, okay? This is a tumultuous shaking that brings up this massive storm on the seas. So big was the storm, in fact, that the boat was being swamped. Now, boats are typically built to be safe on the water, right? They know what waters they're going to put a boat on, and they want to build a boat safe enough to handle those waters. Well, whatever it was about this event is that it's too much for this boat, so that the boat itself is being swamped. And you can imagine just wave after wave after wave is just pouring into the boat. So much so that you begin to look down at your feet, and I mean, the floorboards are vanishing in the water. You can hear the howling winds. So much so that you have to yell just to be heard or to hear someone else. I mean, this is a storm of near hurricane proportions. I mean, it's the kind of things, guys, that would make a sailor wet their pants. I mean, they're grabbing anything that they possibly can to just begin to bail water, right? And if they can't get enough water out, then I'll just throw a buddy out. I don't know. Like, they're beginning to freak out, right? What do we do in this kind of a storm? How do we keep the boat upright? And as you're thinking that, a wave hits you. How do you keep your own feet upright? And all of a sudden it hits you. I'm going to die. This boat cannot handle this. I cannot handle this. And they realize they're in danger of drowning. And once we get that picture of that scale of a storm, wave after wave pouring in, where do we find Jesus? Asleep. Don't let the irony, like, pass you by here, right? A tumultuous storm, and Jesus is asleep. Now, there's incredible irony here, because just before this, Jesus said to one of the guys that was a would-be disciple, he says, I'll follow you. And Jesus says, the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. And yet the one who has nowhere to lay his head, ironically and quite paradoxically, in the very next verses, is found asleep in a storm. You have to ask the question, why? I mean, why did Jesus take a nap? I mean, he's been with the crowds, he's been serving, he's been pouring himself out from the Sermon on the Mount to all these different healings that are going on. Jesus, I believe, is just exhausted. He's exhausted from ministry, he's exhausted from the crowds. You could maybe argue, well, just say, well, Jesus was lazy. I mean, you could try and make that argument, or Jesus is asleep in a storm. You could look at it and say, well, he's just being foolish. That's a really bad time to take a nap, right? Or maybe Jesus is just completely oblivious. He's ignorant. Or could it be that Jesus, even in a storm, is so at peace that he could sleep? Sleep, interestingly enough, and we talked about it a little bit last Wednesday as we were going through 1 Samuel, is often either a gift or a weapon of God's. God often puts his enemies to sleep. And there's times where folks sneak into enemy camps, like Saul. Saul was put into a deep sleep, and all his army, Abner, who is the commander over it, they all fall asleep, and David and his buddy just waltz into the middle of a camp of 3,000 guys that want to kill them. But the Lord put them all to sleep. But other times, sleep is actually a gift from God, like in Psalm 3. David is fleeing for his life because his son Absalom wants to take over his empire. And Absalom at this point is doing a great job. David has to flee to get out of Jerusalem. And as he's on the run, he says this, "But you, O Yahweh, are a shield about me, my glory and the lifter of my head. I cried aloud to the Lord and he answered me from his holy hill. I lay down and slept. And I got to wake up again because the Lord sustained me." See, in the middle of David's chaos, he's able to rest. To fall asleep, to close his eyes. When there's men out who want to kill him, he can sleep because he knows God is the one who protects him. You see, sleep like this is actually proof of radical trust in God's protection, in God's sustaining ability to keep you afloat, to keep you safe, even amidst a storm. This kind of sleep, it's proof of Jesus's humanity. I mean, just the fact that he wants to get away from the crowds. And he's exhausted. He's trusting God. He lays down his head and he sleeps. You see, Jesus has this radical trust in God, so much so that it's unshaken by the circumstances and the anxieties that plague us with fear. Circumstances that plague us with fear, Jesus can rest in the midst of. There's this picture of it. And then in verse 25, we're back to the disciples. Now, they went and they woke him, saying, "Save us, Lord. We're perishing." Now, think about this. As wave after wave is crashing into their face, I mean, on a really unlucky wave, you might catch a few fish in there, right? Slapping you in the face as well. And so these waves are pouring into the boat. Jesus is asleep. And you just wonder, like, at what point did they cry out to Jesus? Like, how long did it take before they realized, we can't handle this? We're drowning. We are too deep into this. I mean, how bad did it have to get before the disciples realized that it was beyond themselves? However bad it had to get, they get to that point because there's these two timeless confessions. The first one is "save us." The second one is we're perishing. So just imagine like how the disciples would be feeling. First thing that came to my mind when I asked that question, wet. Right? Like, just state the obvious. They're feeling wet. They're in the midst of a storm. They're drenched with water. They're probably cold, but they're also here fearful. They're afraid. They're feeling helpless and endangered. And so you can imagine, like, what's the tone in which they say, "Hey, save us, Lord. We're perishing." Do you think that's how it went down? No, remember, they have to scream above the howl of the wind and the waves, and they go over to Jesus. I don't know which guy it was. I don't know if they shook him or whatever. They're like, "Save us! We're perishing!" They cry out to God because this is how they feel, just like the psalmist in Psalm 42, verse 7. He says, "Deep calls to deep at the roar of your waterfalls, and all your breakers and your waves have gone over me." See, back in Psalm 42, David understood this feeling of wave after wave. Like if you've ever gone out to the beach and you go out and one wave knocks you down, right? You're kind of choking on salt water. You stand back up. And as soon as you do, what happens? Right? Another wave just hits you in the face. And the psalmist knows when he says this in Psalm 42, he says, "All of your waves and breakers have come over me." He recognizes what's going on in his life, that God is sovereign over it. The disciples, they don't recognize that yet. But wave after wave is hitting them in the face. And I imagine, did they feel regretful? Like, you know that feeling when you get into a roller coaster and you strap on that harness, you hear it clicking? Every time I have a split second of panic, right? Where you try to like push it back and you're like, this thing's not gonna move. I'm in for the ride, right? I cannot get out. That moment of regret before the moment of exhilaration, right? For some of you, it's just regret all the way through, right? And then the guy behind you who gets whatever came out of you, like it's regret for him too, right? You know that feeling. I just wonder, did the disciples regret ever having gotten into the boat? Did they regret in this moment following Jesus? "Jesus, I'd rather be back on the shore right now. I don't want to be wet and cold and fearful and desperate and helpless. I want to be back with the crowd." And yet this is a story about discipleship. And they're in the boat. So in verse 26, Jesus, you know, kind of rubs his eyes, gets maybe the water out of it. And he must have yelled back. And he said to them, "Why are you afraid, O you of little faith? Why are you afraid?" And then there's these two rebukes. The first one is this. It's a rebuke to the disciples. He says, "Why are you afraid?" And in Matthew's version of the story, he heightens the tension for us from what you'll find in Mark. Because in Mark, Jesus, he calms the storm and then he has a little Q&A with them. Here, Jesus wakes up and he rebukes his disciples first. The waves are still coming in and he asks this question, "Why are you afraid?" I mean, it's not really a good time for Q&A, right? I mean, you can just imagine, why are you afraid? Why do you think we're afraid? You know, they're choking on water. Why do you think we're afraid, Jesus? Because this is more than we can handle. We're perishing. We're going to die. They're in underwater. This is more than they can handle. And church, don't buy into the lie that God will not give you more than you can handle. Because right now the disciples have more than they can handle. Save us. We're perishing. They are going to die. They're going to die. So you have to ask themselves the question. Jesus said, "Let's go over to the other side." Did Jesus call his disciples into the boat
only to destroy them before they got to where he was going to get them? I don't think they were asking themselves that question, but Jesus knew. He said, let's go over to the other side. First in the boat, he knows what's coming, but the disciples don't. So in the middle of the lake, now they're fearful. They think they're going to die. And maybe begin to believe that Jesus called them into the boat only to destroy them. So Jesus says, why are you afraid? Why do you think they're afraid, Jesus? And Jesus answers. He tells them why they're afraid by what he calls them. He says, oh, you of little, what? Faith. They're afraid because they lack faith. This is the second time now that Jesus has said his disciples have little faith. The last one was in Matthew 6. We did it in like 2003 or something like that. This is a long time ago, right? Matthew 6, verse 30. He says, if that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today, and then it's thrown into the fire tomorrow, if God takes care of nature and the grass of the field, how much more will he clothe you, O you of little faith? See, last time Matthew uses this word for little faith, it's about unbelief in the Father's good provision. And Jesus says, you're afraid because you lack faith. You lack faith in God's provision to get you where he invited you to come, where he said he was going to get you. Let's go to the other side. Follow me. And he was the first one in the boat. But the disciples here, knowing that you're at the end of yourself, that's where they are. But they have little faith because they're not yet trusting that God has them, that God is with them. They're not trusting that God will actually get them to where he's bringing them. They think they're going to perish along the way. So he says, oh, you of little faith. The second rebuke is to the wind and the waves. I learned something studying this passage. One of those things was this, that this word for rebuke is the same word Matthew uses elsewhere for exorcism. When Jesus casts out demons, it's a rebuke on the demons. When Jesus rebukes the storm, it's the same word. Jesus has authority over both the demonic and over nature, the natural and the supernatural. Parallel, Jesus has authority over these. And the amazing thing that happens when Jesus rebukes the storm is the same amazing thing that happens when Jesus exorcises demons. They obey. They obey. And here, this amazing thing is there was a great calm. So to the same degree that the storm was cataclysmic, all of a sudden this calm sets in and the storm is reversed at one command of this man. I mean, all of a sudden, the blue sky breaks in. All of a sudden, these massive, towering waves just start gently lapping against the boat. All of a sudden, the boat begins to balance, and with a howling wind calming down, you can hear the creaking of the wood. As the ship settles down, the tempestuous seas come to a calm peace. At just one command of this man. Now understand the disciples, they're still soaking wet. I mean, they're waist deep in water still. And in verse 27, though, we get a glimpse inside the men. They say they marveled. And they ask this question, what sort of man is this that even the winds and the seas obey him? It doesn't say that the disciples asked this question. It says the men, as though Matthew is trying to highlight this point that these are mortal humans. These are just mere human beings. Not even disciples, just wondering, what sort of man is this? These mortal men ask. What sort of man that even the winds and the waves obey him? Later on, in another aquatic episode of sorts, the disciples will answer that very question. What sort of man is this? But in the story right after this, it is actually a demon that tells us what sort of man this is. And he calls Jesus the very Son of God. What sort of man is this? A mortal who can sleep? And yet the Son of God that has authority over the winds and the waves and the demons, sin, disease, and sickness. What sort of man is this who can heal the sick, who can sleep in a storm, who can hush a storm? He can cast out evil and he can bring chaos to peace. What sort of man is this? I mentioned this last week in my own life has been a little bit crazy. It was a bit of a triage kind of a week. Like it was emergency where everything had to kind of jumble up and shift around so we could take care of things that were more of a priority.
is then that Pete offered, he said, hey, I could take this off your plate. And I said, this is the sermon I need to hear. And so I stand before you this morning in a sense, church, I'm still soaking wet. I mean, still in the midst of the storm, trying to wait for it to calm down, soaking wet. This is the message that I need to hear. And as I've been studying this, I've been talking to myself, trying not to listen to myself, but to talk to myself. And these are the three questions that I've been answering. So these are the three I want to put to you. The first question is this. First question is this that I'm answering to myself is, who is in the boat? Who is in the boat? Jesus. Jesus is in the boat. I'm not alone. You are not alone. Jesus got in the boat first. You chose to follow Jesus into the boat. Jesus knows where the boat's going, and he's going to get the boat there no matter what happens in between. Who is in the boat? You see, Jesus here, he's not like a passive deity. He's not like an inaccessible man upstairs. No, he is in the boat. He's not a mere philosophical concept to ponder in times of difficulty. No, he's with his disciples in the boat. He's not an impersonal force that you don't even know the name of. No, Jesus is with his disciples in the boat. He's not merely a passive observer looking down from heaven on what's going on in your life. No, Jesus is with me. Jesus is with his disciples in the boat. Jesus is not a cruel puppet master throwing waves at you, trying to drown you. No, Jesus is with his disciples in the boat. See, Jesus is with you if you've chosen to follow him into the boat. He got in the boat first. He knows where he's taking it. He knows where it is. He knows what's coming. And he got into the boat first, called you to follow. So church, who's with you in the boat? Ask yourself this question. Matthew's already answered it for us. Earlier on, he said, this is Emmanuel. This is God with us. That's at the very beginning of Matthew. We find God with us. At the very end of Matthew, Matthew 28, Jesus says, look, I am with you always. Elsewhere in scripture in Hebrews, Jesus says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Paul, in one of his great writings in Romans chapter 8, he says, who shall separate us from the love of God? I mean, shall tribulation or distress or persecution, famine, nakedness, danger or sword? None of these things can separate us from the love of God. No, in all things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. Because Jesus is in the boat. He's in the boat with me. And if you are a disciple of Jesus, he is in the boat with you. So ask yourself this question. Talk to yourself and remind yourself that Jesus is in the boat. And if Jesus is in the boat, the second question, why are you afraid? Why are you afraid? You see, fear begins to spiral us down as we listen to ourselves. That critic, those voices, I'm not good enough, I don't have what it takes. You see, we fear when we listen to ourselves. We listen to ourselves and we get overwhelmed with the circumstances, not the company. The company of who's in the boat. We begin to fear when we listen to ourselves about the storm and not about the Savior. About our peril and not about his power. The result of this is fear, it is not faith. It is panic, it is not peace. Why are you afraid? As wave after wave is hitting you in the face, and church, we know some of those waves. We know some of those faces. Some of you have been faced with death after death after death. Some by old age, by murder, and by suicide. Wave after wave keeps coming. For others of you, it's been miscarriage after miscarriage, sometimes two at a time. Wave after wave keeps coming. For other of you, it's chemo after chemo after chemo, and the cancer just won't go away. Or it's weekend after weekend after weekend just battling for custody, trying to be a single parent. Or holiday after holiday, and your children still won't call. They still won't answer, and they still won't come home. Or day after day, for some, even just listening now, they're suffering in isolation. Because of COVID, their kids won't let them leave the house. They can't get out. And day after day, it's like wave after wave of suffering is coming. Month after month, it could be that the bills are piling up. and there's more month than there is paycheck, and you're beginning to drown. It could be depression or anxiety, divorce or death. Life is overwhelming as wave after wave is hitting you in the face. Could be something recent. It could be that they just found a lump in your breast. It could be that you just got called into the doctor's office or into your boss's office and you no longer have a job. You might be finding blood where it shouldn't be. Again, a letter from the creditors. You come home and the lock on your front door is broken, or there's threatening texts that keep arriving. A phone call that a son or daughter has been in a car wreck. Wave after wave as you're choking on fluid that keeps filling in your lungs. Or the discovery that a spouse has been unfaithful. Wave after wave is hitting you in the face, leaving you choking, desperate, and powerless, and afraid. Deep calls to deep at the roar of your waterfalls. All of your breakers and your waves have gone over me, says the psalmist. All of these things, church, they bring us to the end of our rope. I mean, empty, inadequate, and powerless, despairing, desperate, depressed, and despondent. Do any of these things describe you? We're afraid for our lives, sometimes wishing that it would just end altogether. But we're reminded that he that is with us is greater than the storm that surrounds us. You see, church, faith is never a matter of how much, but a matter of who. It's not the degree or the capacity of your faith, but rather the object of your faith that makes all the difference. You see, you could have the faith that's the size of a mountain, that you could jump off of a mountain and fly. But what's going to happen? You're not going to get off the ground. Doesn't matter how much faith you have. But if you have faith in the right object, in the right person, you can have faith that's the size of a mustard seed and say to this mountain, move, and it will move. See, the disciples have little faith because they have no faith in who Jesus is. And yet we're reminded, why are we afraid? You see, disciples who leave everything to follow Jesus can trust that he is able to preserve them and get them to where he's promised he will take them. So ask yourselves, who is in the boat? And so why am I afraid? And then the third question is this, answer to yourself what the disciples ask. What sort of man is this? I mean, what sort of man do you say that Jesus is? Is he mean, lazy, indifferent, uncaring? What sort of man does the scripture show him to be? Church, he is powerful and caring. He is a servant and a restorer of life, one who can rest in the midst of a storm. In fact, the structure of Matthew is all designed to keep asking, having us ask this question of like, what sort of man is this? You'll remember that in this passage, in these passages of Matthew, there's three sets of three stories, nine of them all together. And each set of three is punctuated by a call to follow me. We went through the first three, and then Jesus said, follow me. Now we're at number four, and we're there in the storm asking, what sort of man is Jesus? In the first three stories, Jesus was not catering to the social or the religious elite, but rather he was bringing the kingdom of God to heal the broken and the marginalized. That's who Jesus is. And then he says, follow me. And now in these next couple stories, we find these three different miracles of this man showing divine authority. Divine authority exercised over nature, over demons, and over sin. And then again, the call will come, follow me. If we follow him into the next three stories, we'll find that this man is a man who has incredible compassion, so much so that he gives the dead life. He gives the blind sight and he makes the mute to speak. That's the sort of man Matthew is showing us Jesus is. So what sort of man is this? Rich Mullins back in the day, yes, I know who Rich Mullins is, some of you may, he wrote a song, and one of the lines from it says this, of a kingdom of paupers, simpletons, and rogues, the whores all seem to love him, and the drunks propose a toast. Who is this man? What kind of man is he? The psalmist says in Psalm 89, O Lord, God of armies, who is mighty as you are, O Lord, with your faithfulness all around you, You rule the raging of the sea. When its waves rise up, you still them. You see, Jesus is showing himself to be the Messiah, who is the very Son of God himself, fully man, exhausted and asleep on a boat, and yet fully God with authority to bring peace to chaos. Saving, in fact, is the very work that Jesus came to do, not merely to save us from storms, but to save you from your sins. When you cry out, "Save us, Lord, we're perishing." Can Jesus save? We're told earlier by the angel, this is why Jesus came in Matthew chapter 1. This was like back in the 90s, right? When we went through this. "She will bear a son and you will call his name Jesus, for he will" what? "Save his people from their sins." Saving, church, is what Jesus came to do. See, when you and I are most desperate, most at the end of ourselves, I mean, most spiraling and wrestling to not listen to ourselves, but talk to ourselves, we're finding ourselves unworthy, unable, dead in our trespasses and sins. Jesus came to save. God loved the world in this way, that he gave his one and only Son. What sort of man is this? This is the sort of man who has come so that you are not forsaken. He is at work to save you. He can give you rest in the middle of a storm. He can calm the storm for you. So why are you cast down, O my soul? Why are you in turmoil within me? Hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my salvation and my God. Church, I pray as you go from this place, that this week you would learn to preach the gospel to yourself, that you would build the discipline and the habit of talking to yourself rather than listening to yourself. And when you do, ask these questions. Remind yourself, who is in the boat? Why are you afraid? And so what sort of man is this? Jesus, many of us this morning sitting in these chairs are in the storm, in the waves. We're soaking wet. We're choking on water. We're thinking we're going to drown. Spirit of the living God, would you remind us that you got in the boat first? You know where the boat is going. You are with us. Would you give us peace? Jesus, I pray that we would bring all of our fear, all of our anxiety to you, and remember that you are a good, good God, a compassionate Father who loves to give his children good things, who clothes the lilies of the field, and so how much more will you care for us? So why are we afraid? Jesus, may we put our faith in you. And Spirit, we pray that we would ask this question and that you would show us who the Son of God is, the sort of man that he is, with compassion to heal, with power to save. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Darkness, you will leave. We can.